još jedna emisija Unisport. Ovoga puta, verujem da će ovo biti jedna od najzanimljivih epizoda u ovoj sezoni, zato što imamo ne tako uobičajenu temu o kojoj ćemo razgovarati i ne tako uobičajenu gošću. Tokom čitave, ne samo ove sezone, već i prethodnih sezona, često smo govorili o sudarskom sportu u Srbiji, ali redko kada smo se dotakli teme kako to izgleda u inostranstvu. Zapravo nismo imali nekoga ko bi nam to ispričao iz prve ruke. Govorili smo o iskustvima naših studenta na međunarodnim takmičenjima, ali evo sada imamo ko može da nam prenese kako studentski sport izgleda u inostranstvu i to ni manje ni više nego u zemlji s koje pravosu koleđa može otići u NBA ili zaigrati u nekoj od profesionalnih liga svijeta. Moja gošća večeras bit će Jenna Luxembo. Ja ću sada predstaviti i tokom emisije moći ćete da čujete zašto je ona ove nedelje u Beogradu, sa kakvim se izazovima, da tako kažemo, susretala ovde i kako uopšte studentski sport i pre svega studentska odbojka izgleda u Americi.
Hi, good evening.
Hello, thank you so much for having me.
I am honored to have you here tonight. I said in the intro right now that you are like a special guest of this season.
Oh my gosh. No,
but I really mean it. Okay, so to present you, first you're a student and a volleyball player, an engineering student of the Marquette University in Milwaukee.
Yep, that's me.
Yeah, first of all, let's start from your stay in Belgrade. What brings you here?
So I came to visit Belgrade in order to attend a volleyball combine put on by Elite Volley. The purpose of this combine was to learn more about volleyball, practice volleyball, training volleyball, but much more than just skills. We were able to practice mental strategies, performance strategies, rehabilitation, strength training, the entire body of work that it takes to become a professional athlete. We were able to practice and learn here in Belgrade for the week, and it was a wonderful journey, and I learned so much, and it was an honor to stay in this beautiful city.
So how has it looked? Let's start from the combine. How has it looked? How many coaches and players were part of it?
So we had one volleyball master volleyball coach, Alessandro Lodi. He did a wonderful job explaining technique and working with us to improve our skills on the court. We also had Ryan J. Owens, who is working with us to improve our our mental game and our strategies and how we approach training. Also, Pavle from CrossFit Privitim over by the river. He came and worked with us on strength training and how to lift weights properly, along with Boris, who worked with us on breathing strategies, core activation, and a few others dropped in and gave their advice and their experiences to us so we can learn from them.
Today, you had your last training
at
a combine. So how do you feel now after so many training sessions? And
I'm lucky, I'm still young. My body feels wonderful even after training very hard for an entire week. And I feel as though I've learned so much and I have so much that I'm able to take with me back to Marquette and continue my training there and keep working and keep getting better, because volleyball is a process. You're never done, never, never, never. And so with these skills, I can keep taking my game to the next level, and that's just wonderful.
Are you tired?
I just had some coffee. I'm great. But I think that's what that's one of my strengths as an athlete, is I don't get tired. I can keep going through quite a lot. So I think that suits me for
So I guess life. That from Belgrade, you're taking a flight to a next challenge?
I wish. But no, I'll be going back home, back to Milwaukee. And that's probably for the better. I've been away for a little bit now. Before Belgrade, the week before Belgrade, I was in China with the USA college national team, and we toured through there and playing teams. I went home for 4 days and then I came here. I probably should have just kept going around the world that way, but I kind of started again, but it's okay.
So you're just going back home?
Just
going. To have some rest?
Maybe a little bit.
But just a little.
Rest is boring.
Okay.
No, I'll go home. Milwaukee is on a very, very large lake, one of the biggest lakes in America, and we have a beach, we have everything, and so I'll take some sun with my friends, we'll probably take a volleyball along and play a little bit of beach volleyball, but it'll be a lot of sleeping in the sun for me.
So during the combine or whenever, maybe in your student's career at the Marquette University, maybe in NCAA division, did you have the opportunity to play against Serbian volleyball players?
I have not. Not until I came to Belgrade. I had never played against the Serbian, any Serbian volleyball players, though I'd known that on the national level that Serbia has a great volleyball team and I respect them a lot. They're always giving USA a run for their money. And I was actually watching the USA-Serbia match last night.
A couple of days ago?
A couple of days ago. It was on TV last night. Yeah. We saw it last night. And Serbia got USA. They won. And my friend Dolores was very, very excited for Serbia to win. And I pouted a little bit. But okay, that's the nature of the game.
And did you have the opportunity to see the city, to explore?
We have been able to explore. The coordinators of the combine were really good at helping to make sure that we can see the city, that clearly we've come here for business, we came here to get our work done, but at the same time, you have to enjoy the fact that you're in a new city, I'm in a new country, I'm very far from home, and so we got to have fun while we're here and experience different things.
And how do you like it? What do you like the most?
Oh, I love it. We went down to the Splavs this weekend, and I thought they were just beautiful, beautiful.
Okay, so we're already going to the night out.
Oh, no. The Splavs stick out in my mind, but just the general kindness of the people and how everyone's willing to help out a poor American girl who knows Havala and Dobro Juto. That's about it.
They're close.
Close. They're willing
Dobro
to help me.
Jutro. Yeah. Dobro. But you were close.
Okay.
Really close.
That's why people gave me funny looks, maybe.
Okay. As I have already mentioned, you are an engineering student at Marquette University, but also a volleyball player on your college team. So I can't wait to hear how university sports work in the USA. So what does it mean to be an athlete and student at the same time at the USA? I think it's normal for you, for your culture.
Yeah.
But what does it mean for you to be a student and an athlete at the same time?
For me, it's a lot of responsibility. You essentially play two lives. You do the same things as every other student, but you also have another life of volleyball, and you have to commit yourself to volleyball as well. And that can sometimes be a challenge, but I love that challenge because I can't imagine my life without volleyball now because it's just become such a part of what I do. And so it requires a lot of time management and carefully keeping track of what you need to do and your responsibilities, but that's part of why I love it, because I'm restless, because if you're not doing something, then what are you doing? Nothing. And so if that makes any sense, but to be able to do both is a really special thing, and I think my teammates are just amazing, and how we are able to go through life as both, and we get to enjoy both, and that's a really special thing for us, and I love it.
Mm-hmm. And your university has more than 11,000 students.
Yes.
I have explored a little bit. And 15 girls can be in a roster for volleyball team.
Yes.
So what does it take to become a part of that team?
Now, it's interesting because at the Division I level, because I play in the NCAA, so the NCAA includes all universities, or most all universities in the United States, and there's three levels. There's Division I, which is the top, where Marquette is, and then there's 2 and 3. And at most Division I universities, the team is not picked from the students there. In America, you go to university at 18. However, me and my teammates have been promised to go to Marquette since we were 15 or 16. And so you're playing youth sports, you're just a kid, you're in school, and you join a travel team. And so you go around different states playing and playing and playing, and college scouts are there, and they watch. And then they identify the players they want for their team. You come out to the university, you visit, you ask them questions, and then you sign a contract to come and play for the university, for sometimes for scholarships and sometimes for not. And so there's really no tryout at the university level. If a girl wanted to join the team from the general university, of course there could be a special exception, but the roster of our team is filled for the next 3 years because girls are promised and they're planned on coming. Our new girls are already training with the team right now, even though classes won't start for another 2 months, because a lot of it is set in stone. Well, not set in stone. A lot of it is planned before we come. And in that way, I think student athlete is sometimes a misnomer, because we are very, it's professional. It's a business. I am fortunate enough to have my education completely paid for as a result of being on the volleyball team. And so I take that as a very great responsibility that I am being essentially paid. It's not paid, obviously. Yeah. It's you know, tuition and books and my apartment, but I'm there to do a job. They brought me there to play volleyball and train hard, and so I live up that expectation every day. In that sense, it is a job, and it's not just a thing you do. It's my job.
Okay, so you've mentioned the contract that you have to sign,
mm-hmm.
and what are your obligations due to that contract?
So, what are you allowed or not allowed to do? Oh. What are you obligated to do?
There are lots and lots of rules, and there are also rules that aren't written in the contract, but for one thing, optional. The word optional. Optional. It's, you better do it, but they can't make you do it. But everyone does it because they understand what optional really means. So, like a typical season for us will be begin light training in July. Everyone comes back to campus, works out in the weight room, conditioning once a day, and plays volleyball with each other, not with our coaches, in the evenings. That's all for July. And then when August comes, that's when the real responsibility begins, because we will train 2 to 3 times a day, 2 volleyball practices and a strength and conditioning training on most days. And you're expected to be in the gym, show up, be ready, have your mind right, and be ready to learn and help this team grow. And after the month of August, we begin our regular season, where we are traveling and practicing, and that's the meat of our season. We go, we compete, you go back, you learn from your mistakes, you learn about your next opponent, and you continue. And so a lot of people will ask me, like, oh, how many times a week do you practice? And I'm like, every day. It is a job, and you're expected to do something for volleyball every day. And so, well, of course, Sundays, you know, have some time off to reflect and not go completely crazy. But as a result of our obligations, we are with the team, we train, we work hard from September to December when our season ends, but it never ends. It's a year-round commitment, because as soon as the new year begins, we start building our strength for the coming season and working hard that way in the weight room and also in the gym, trying to get our skills ready for the next season to come. And once again, all the applause in the world to my teammates for coming with me on this wonderful journey, because without their support, you know, a team doesn't function without its players. So, yeah.
And how hard it is to be a part of a team on college and, you know, giving your exams, being a good student at first, mm-hmm. and then at the same time being a pro volleyball player, because you definitely do play on a pro level.
Mm-hmm. So it's difficult, because you want to give your most attention to volleyball, because that's what we love. That's what brought us to Marquette University was volleyball, and so you want to give all of your attention to that, but it's equally as important to make sure you remain a student in good standing with the university. And sometimes that means taking exams when we're traveling. Marquette competes in the Big East Conference, so we travel to New York or Washington, D.C. or New Jersey or a bunch of places on the East Coast, so about every other weekend, we're hopping on a plane and flying to a whole new part of the country. And we're fortunate to have an academic advisor, Katie. She travels with us most of the time, and she's able to administer tests on the road, because sometimes your professor can't move the test, but your test is still due. And so she'll come with us and provide the exam and, you know, ensure that we're not that we don't cheat, but, you know, ensure that everything is conducted in a safe manner. Yes. And especially when final exams or midterm exams come, it's just a part of what you do. You have to make sure you can juggle both responsibilities really well. But we have a great support system with us, and that's what makes it possible, because it is very challenging, but without their help.
Okay, in Serbia, so let's just make a comparison. Mm-hmm. There's a dominant stereotype that university sports leagues are just another form of an amateur sport. Mm-hmm. But actually, it's not. We had national team players playing university leagues, mm-hmm. but that stereotype is still dominant. So in America, that's the only way to play on a high level before becoming pro, am I right?
Yeah, predominantly yes. Of course, there are some few exceptions about people managing to break through from lower university levels to find success on the professional level, but for many, many girls, that the dream of a Division I scholarship is the height of their career. Like, that is the highest volleyball goes in the United States because we don't have professional leagues. And the way we act and the way we carry out our training is a very professional manner. We are issued gear. We are required to, it's funny, we like to joke, they tell us what to wear, when to wear it, when to be at a place. Sometimes they tell us what to eat. They tell us when to sleep. They tell us what to do. You know, a lot of it is directed because we have, you know, we signed this contract. We agreed to perform our job. And in that way, it's a very professional way to go
are
about training.
Are those one of the optional things?
Yeah, some of those are. No, those are all rules. Because we're given a team handbook of team policies and team procedures. And so in that, one example might be what we have to wear to practice. Because we all must wear the university shirt that we are given, long sleeves, Marquette University volleyball. We all must wear our blue shorts, white knee pads, white tall socks, and then the team shoes that we're given. And it's just not possible that, like, I can't even conceive of wearing something else to practice because it's just not what you do. And sometimes my friends that don't understand it would say, but what happens if you miss practice? And I don't understand that question because you can't miss practice. That's just not in our vocabulary. It's an obligation. You have to be there. Unless, I've been trying to think if there would be an appropriate circumstance in which it would be okay to miss practice. But
have you ever missed a practice during the college?
Well, my grandfather did pass, and obviously that I was given some time to leave. I was given a day to leave. However, at that point in my career, I was sitting out. And so as of right now, I don't. As captain or taking a leadership position and being a starter for the last 4 years, I would not feel comfortable leaving practice because if you miss a practice, you're not prepared for the coming game, and that would be a disservice to my team and everyone in our program who expects us to win and perform well if I didn't do the proper preparation to be ready for our competition.
Wow.
I make it sound completely crazy, but we do have tons of fun. Like, we do like doing this, of course, and the way I talk about it makes it sound like
yeah,
a dreadful thing.
But for me, it really is wow, because here it looks a little bit different.
Okay.
There are no so many obligations, or especially not rules, especially not books about what you should do. But
like, they require us to study for certain hours in a certain place to make sure we're doing our homework, because so many players, because you come to the university to play volleyball, people think, oh yes, volleyball, then school, blah. Well, no, you have to make sure you do school as well, because we are student athletes. You have to make sure you have both, a balance of both. And I think in America, it's much easier to shift into athlete mode too easily, but we have to remember we have other responsibilities as well.
Do you have free time at all?
Yes. Yeah, it's a different kind of free time. During August, we have free time for, in between trainings, and we have a very nice locker room. And in our locker room, we have a very large television and some bean bags. It's like there's a locker room, and then we have a team lounge. And so a typical day of preseason training would be practice at 8 a.m., which means you need to be in the gym at 7:30 to prepare. We'll practice for 2 hours, take a break, eat lunch together as a team, you know, all the players, all of our coaches, all of our staff, because we want to make sure it is a family. Everyone in our program is special and so important, and we all eat together like a family, so we can talk about how our day was, even though it seems silly because we were just together all day, but somehow we still get to talk about that. And then, you know, after we eat as a group, us players will go into the lounge. We like to watch TLC, which is just a bunch of reality shows. And so we all sit on the beanbag. We take a nap for an hour, maybe an hour and a half, before we go back out onto the court. And so in August, we don't leave the gym until the night. And by then, you're very, very tired, so you go to sleep and wake up and do it again. But during our off season, yeah, we have time. You know, you just make sure you get your obligations done, and then you can go and have fun and make sure you're resting appropriately so that you're prepared for the next training. But it's what you signed up for.
But what you love to do when you have some free time?
Me, personally, I started going to concerts recently. I really like concerts.
Really?
And so if I ever get the dates to line up, you know, if I'm not, when my favorite band comes to town, I'm like, oh, I'm so excited. Then I look at the calendar, I'm like, ah, shoot, I'm somewhere else training or playing a match. But when there's time, I like to do that. Otherwise, my friends and I love to explore Milwaukee. It's a beautiful, beautiful city. There's the gorgeous lakefront, lots of paths and beautiful cafes to explore and, you know, just hanging out with friends. Any normal student stuff. We are still normal students. We're just a little bit more busy than everyone else, but that's okay.
For you, mm-hmm. what does it mean to be a part of Golden Eagles? What does it mean for you?
It's so hard to describe what it means because I love every aspect of Marquette University. It's made me so, so happy over the last 4 years that I've been able to be a part of this program. It's given me a new life as a professional athlete because I never thought that I could do any of these things. And here I am talking to you in Belgrade. If you would have told me that I'd be doing this when I first, you know, signed the contract for Marquette, I would have laughed at you. But Marquette University is such a special place, and it's full of so many special people that it's home. The gym is home because at the gym we have our training facility, we have our weightlifting facility, we have our study area, we have our coaches' offices, we have our locker room and our lounge. It's really a place where you are home and you can do the work you need to do to be the best you can be, and that they provide everything you might need to accomplish your goals is something so, so special. And as a result of that, all you want to do is make them proud and compete well and represent well. And when people ask you, where do you play? You can say Marquette University and tell them all about the wonderful people that you've met there. Everyone cares. It's a small school. I know you said 11,000, and that's small.
Yeah.
That is
for America, that's small.
That's very small in America. And so everyone loves and supports each other, all the different sports. It's a special community of people organized together for one purpose. Mm-hmm. And
so you said you want to make people around you proud.
Yes.
Is that what gives you the biggest strength to play?
I think there's so many things that are able to give me the strength to play, and that is one of them, because I love my team. My teammates are everything, because if I can play for them and help them win, help us win together as a group and do something special that no Marquette team has ever done. We've had good success in the recent past. We qualify for the national tournament. We've qualified every year for the past 7 years, which is something to be very, very proud of, because out of 300 Division I schools, only 64 teams are selected for the national tournament. And that we make it every year is a testament to the hard work that we do. It makes it all worth it. But making people proud, yes. Making myself proud also is very, very important, because you have to be a little bit crazy to do all of the things we do. But a result of that crazy is trying to see what you can really do and how far you can go, and making an impact on the lives of others along the way is really, really important, because you also cannot be so closed off and about yourself. You have to make sure you take others with you on this wonderful, wonderful opportunity we've been given.
Now I have a little bit stupid question.
That's okay.
First, how tall are you?
I am 6 feet and 6 inches tall, and my European friends tell me that is 1 meter and 98.
So that's pretty much, yeah.
Yeah.
So now goes that little bit stupid question. Is there a guy tall enough at a campus to be your boyfriend?
There are. The basketball players are. Some of them are taller than me. But
in condition that you can wear high heels when you go out with them?
There was one. His name was Harry. He was an Australian. And he's actually playing in the Australian Professional League right now. And I ran into him one evening. I like to wear heels like this. And I was pleasantly surprised to discover that he was my height.
I would love to have your height and play on the level that you play. So maybe I don't have problems with my height, but it would definitely be better for me.
I love my height because it's given me so many opportunities to do things. And, you know, I think it's all so important to make sure we're comfortable with the skin we're in,
yeah,
because it makes me so sad to see younger players who are still shorter than me by maybe this much, and they hide because they don't like sticking out. I'm like, honey, you're not hiding. You're still tall, so you might as well stand tall and be proud and be beautiful and help radiate, you know, what makes you you instead of trying to close that off inside. And so I hope maybe I live in a way that inspires others to be big and bold and, you know, just be unapologetic in who you are. And I think that's my big message for everyone is no matter what you do, even if it's volleyball or if it's football or, you know, maybe it's not sports, maybe you're theater. My little brother does theater. He's an art kid. And as long as you're doing what you love and you radiate happiness and a wonderful energy to those around you, you can't help but lift them up. And I think that's what we all need to do is help contribute something to make the world a better place and make everyone, you know, shine a little bit brighter.
Yeah, those are beautiful sentences. I'm like looking at you like this.
Oh.
And yeah, who cares if you're taller than your boyfriend? Who cares? Yeah.
Like, that's why I wear heels, because at this point, I'm taller than most everyone anyway, so what's the difference?
Yeah.
Even if there was?
Well, hey. I'm kidding, of course, but you said something really, really nice, and I don't know, I admire you so much at this point of view.
Thank you so much.
Okay, for the end of our talk, can you tell me your plans for the future? Where do you see yourself in like 5 or 10 years?
Oh, in 5 or 10 years, I hope I'm still playing volleyball. I go back to Marquette University.
What I hope? I don't want to hear that. I hope you're young.
Hey, nothing is for granted, okay? Like, sometimes, what's the quote? Like, the carefully laid plans of mice and men often, you know. So you look forward to the future, but you understand that nothing is given to you and nothing is permanent. And so in 5 to 10 years, I want to still be playing volleyball, traveling the world, Europe, China maybe. And at that point, I'm training for the goal of being the best I can be. Because if I live up to my full potential, then that's all you need. Because if you live up to your full potential and you don't make a different specific goal, you knew you gave it your everything. And you can't be mad at that. You can't help but be happy at the fact that you have extended yourself fully and you saw what you're capable of, and that is wonderful. And it would be amazing and such an honor to continue to represent the United States of America in volleyball, and that would make me the happiest girl in the world. But that's a silly goal, because that there are hundreds and hundreds of girls who also want the same thing. And so at that point, we have to remember to ourselves that the only thing you can do is be the best you can be. And so if we can strive for that and work for that, then wherever you end up, you will be happy and you will be content. And I think that's what we all want, is to be able to continue to do what we love. And in my case, it's volleyball. And so I will make a living and I will make my life in pursuit of excellence. And yeah, I think that.
And you won't be satisfied because you gave your best.
Yes. Yeah. That's a good way of ending it.
Okay. Jenna, thank you so much for your time tonight. I really feel so honored to have the possibility to talk to you. And after our talk, I'm pretty sure that you represent your university, that you represent Marquette in the best possible way, not just on a court, but also in your life, in your private life, or in your studies, wherever. But you're really, I don't know, your story, your quotes, everything you said tonight was so fantastic. And thank you so much for sharing it with us.
Thank you. I'm so glad you're willing to listen. And if anyone wants to come along on the crazy ride that is my life, I'm on Instagram. I don't know. You know, Jenna9 Rosenthal, because right now I'm number 9. But
okay, hey. So whoever wants can send you a message.
Yeah, no, I love answering questions about what I do, because that's how I share my experience, because I've had so much good fortune, and I want to make sure I can share some of that with everyone. So if anyone wants to ask
And that's also a way to help somebody else who definitely needs an advisor.
Because I was able,
like that.
I did that with some people on the national team right now. Dustin Watton plays for Team USA, the men's side. And he's...
I'm also following him.
Oh, he's so good. I love him. He is honestly the best. And I wrote him asking him some, you know, a question about mental training, and he wrote right back and said, hey, these are the same problems I have. And it was just so special to be able to be like, wow, I think he's just wonderful, but at the same time, he's just a person like you or me, and he's willing to help spread his light. And
that's what you're willing to do also. Thank you so much for sharing your experiences, and I hope to see you again, maybe one day, as a player of the American national team here in Belgrade, playing against Serbia. I will definitely cheer for my national team, but my heart will be next to you, I promise.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
All right.
Dragi gledalci, bila je ovo Jenna Rosenbaum. A mi idemo dalje, sada ćete čuti priču dve mlade dame koje će, možda slušajući Jenninu priču, poći njenim koracima, ali definitivno su se odlučile da svoje studije i svoju karijeru nastave u inostranstvu. Čućete i zašto. Kao što sam već najavila, sada ćemo razgovarati sa dve mlade devojke koje još uvek nisu studentkinje, ali će to kroz nekoliko meseci biti. Razgovarat ćemo o njihovim izborima i zašto su odlučile da studiraju u inostranstvu, a ono što ih povezuje sa našom prvom gošćom večeras, odnosno sa Jennom, jeste kamp kom su i one prisustvovale. Dakle, agencija Elite Volley je organizovala jedan kamp u aprilu, jedan sada u junu, i moje večerašnje gošće bile su deo aprilskog kampa, ali su imale priliku da upoznaju i sve učesnice ovog junskog, da sa njima porazgovaraju, da čuju šta ih to očekuje u inostranstvu i kakve će studije za njih biti. Moje gošće večeras su Una Stević i Nevena Santranč. Devojke, dobroveče!
Dobroveče!
Nisam imala mlađe gošće nikad ovde. jako mi je drago što ste ovde, vi ste nam i dalje srednjoškolke, zvanično, je li tako? Predavanja su se završila, ali ostalo je tu par još završnih ispita do tog konačnog zvanja, je li tako? Una, ti završavaš 9. gimnaziju, Nevena, ti završavaš ekonomsku školu u Zemunu. I ono što vas povezuje sa Jennom, kao što sam pomenula, jeste vaše učešće na kampu Elite Volley. Kako je za vas to bilo iskustvo? Vi ste bile deo aprilskog kampa, imali ste priliku da sarađujete sa mnogim igračicama iz inostranstva, da sa njima trenirate, da vidite kako to izgleda kod njih. Pa kako je bilo? Una, pa ćemo tebe.
Pa može. Za mene to bilo ogromno iskustvo. Naravno, iako sam odlučila da nastavim karijeru i studije u Americi, nikada nisam imala priliku da zapravo treniram i igram sa devojkama iz Amerike, između ostalog sa devojkama iz inostranstva, pošto su kamp posetile i devojke iz Evrope i tako dalje. Tako da, stvarno jedna divna prilika da se upoznam sa načinom njihovog treniranja, razmišljenja sa njihovom kulturom i uopšte ideje o sportu, da kažem mentaliteta, kako oni gledaju na sve to. Naravno i rad sa stranim trenerima, američkim i trenerima iz Evrope, to stvarno mnogo znači za mene.
Nevena?
Pa da, pre svega imam veliko iskustvo upoznati devojke iz Amerike, iz inostranstva i trenirati sa trenerima iz inostranstva. Prvi put mi se desilo u životu i upoznala sam se sa novim načinima treniranja i veoma psihičkog razmišljanja da se gleda na obliku na drugi način. I onda mi je bilo veoma zanimljivo i interesantno.
I šta je ono za što mislite da ste najviše napredovale? Šta je ono u čemu ste poboljšale? Ajde da krenemo, da li su to neki odbojkaški elementi ili opet ta neka psihička priprema ili možda sve zajedno, jer smo mogli da čujemo i malo pre od Jenne koliko zapravo različitih elemenata obuhvataju ti kampovi.
Pa naravno, mislim da je taj kamp obuhvatio, da kažem, sve što je potrebno. Mislim, u principu to je, traje 7 dana, tako da nemate vi sada vremena da ne znam koliko napredujete, ali to je baš namenjeno tome da se svako da vidi ono što mu fali, skoncentriše se i sredi se da popravi to i samim tim nauči kako da nastavi da se trudi na tome i da dospe do tog svog nekog cilja. Svakako mnogo imaš prilike da radiš na raznim elementima, da unaprediš svaki element, da naučiš ono što ti je potrebno da ga u daljem svom treningu koji nastaviš, dakle da to unaprediš. Takođe, mnogo značajna psihička priprema, zato što kod nas jako malo trenera i klubova se uopšte bavi tom stranom treninga, da kažem mentalnog treninga, na šta recimo američki treneri jako puno više obraćaju pažnje. Tako da to je nešto što je meni eto najviše pomoglo na tom kampu.
Znači kamp je više bio namenjen, da kažemo, na radu na nekim finesama,
da.
Kako da vi do najsitnijih nekih detalja usavršite i svoju tehniku i pripremu i zagrevanje i sve to, nego što je to sad neko, ja tako kažemo, kolektivno vežbanje, da. Treniranje kao što je to običaj kada kažemo reč kamp. To nam je neka prva asocijacija.
Kao kamp, ali individualno, na primjer, vežbali smo stvari koje će doprinjeti nama i podići ih na više nivo. Na primjer, mi sad serviramo, a sad nam pokaže neku caku za serviranje, još bolju, da li da se bolje udari ili jače, i onda je to baš bilo dobro. I naravno, mentalna priprema koju baš mi je začudilo da to postoji uopšte pažnja, tolika da se obraća na glavu i na psihičku pripremu. To mi se baš svidelo.
A to je jako važno, naravno, koliko želimo da igramo neki sport, odnosno da se bavimo nekim sportom na visokom nivou. Čule ste, imali ste priliku da sada u backstage-u čujete razgovor sa Jenom. Kako vam se to čini, kako vam se čine njena iskustva, odnosno njen pogled na samo to studiranje i bavljanje odbojkom na profesionalnom nivou?
Pa, da kažem, to je taj američki ovaj pogled na koji sam...
Američki san, jel da?
Da, 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 jeste. Mnogo drugačije od, recimo, naših razmišljanja, našeg uopšte poimanja svega toga. Doduše, evo već sada polako se navikavam na sve to kako prolazim, upoznajem devojke iz Amerike, shvatam na koji način oni razmišljaju, mnogo je drugačije, ali s jedne strane lepo i mnogo bi bilo lepo kada bi... više ljudi mogli da, kod nas, da gledaju na svet tako. Oni su stvarno pozitivni i to je, recimo, imali smo priliku da pričamo sa trenerima sada na kampu koji su nam govorili da mi nismo tu, ok, vi ste na kampu, vi sada gledate druge devojke i upoređujete se sa njima, ali to nije poenta, vi ste ovde zato što ste već dobri i samim tim što ste dobri, vi samo možete da budete još bolji i ovde je cilj da svako bude bolji nego što je bio, ne sada da se vi upoređujete sa drugima kakvi su i to je stvarno neki način na koji oni razmišljaju, da samo daš sve od sebe i ti ćeš biti srećan jer si ti dao sve od sebe i gde god da doguraš sa tim svojim trudom, ti ćeš biti srećan zbog toga i to je stvarno jedan baš lep pogled na svet koji kod nas znam da jako malo ljudi ima, više svi gledaju šta drugi, kako rade i upoređuju se tako.
Nevena, kako se tebi sve to čini?
Pa da, oni su vrlo pozitivni, optimistični, srećni u vezi svega toga i bukvalno u svakoj sitnici vide neku lepu stvar i sve žele da ulepšaju, sve je lepo, sve je divno i meni se to jako sviđa jer oni bukvalno se osjećaš bolje kao osoba kad si okružen tako pozitivnim ljudima koji šire dobru energiju, mnogo znači. Sportisti mnogo znači sreća, dobra energija, jer ga uzdiže nekako, olakšava se.
Tako je, ta neka pozitiva.
Da.
E sad, ono što je Jenna pomenula, što je jako važno kada su u pitanju studije bilo gde, to je da se pored bavljenja sportom na visokom nivou, da se te studije ne zapostave. I kao što smo mogli da čujemo, dakle, u njihovim timovima postoje ljudi koji su zaduženi za to da oni obavljaju svoje ispitne, predispitne obaveze na vreme, da to sve bude, da sve to prođe u najboljem mogućem redu, isto tako koliko je na terenu. Recite mi, je li to jedan od glavnih razloga zašto ste odlučile da studirate u inostranstvu, odnosno zašto baš Amerika kao taj neki pozitivan primer kako se istovremeno baviti profesionalnim sportom, ali isto tako i ne zapostaviti studije?
Pa upravo tako, to je najveći razlog jer Amerika je, da kažem, jedini meni poznat sistem koji stvarno podržava te sportiste, studente. Koliko god, recimo evo i kod nas, stvarno jednostavno sistem nije tako usklađen da univerziteti rade zajedno sa sportskim savezom u smislu da je to jedan sistem. Tako da stvarno za mene ovde ne bi bilo moguće da, naravno kada pričamo o najvišem nivou profesionalnom, da nastavim sa odbojkom na tom nivou i takođe da budem odličan student. Jednostavno, vremenski prosto to ne bih mogla da uskladim. Već sam imala problem i u srednjoj školi, kada sam ili morala da propuštam časove ili da isto na neke razne načine uspevam da postignem sve obaveze na treninzima. Dok recimo u Americi stvarno jednostavno oni ti učine da naprave tvoj raspored tako da ti uspeš sve da postigneš. I to je samo razlika u sistemu koji tako funkcioniše, tako da sam zato odlučila da tamo nastavim studije.
Bukvalno te po iskustvima, oni čuvaju studente, mislim, studente sve, studente sportiste, kao malo vode na dlan. Daju im sve. Imaju dobru opremu, imaju dobre knjige, smešte, sve. I to mi se jako sviđa i zato što prosto isplaniraju ti dan i ti znaš šta sve da radiš i čuvaju te prosto, tako da kažem.
Tokom prošle godine, zapravo negde tamo početkom leta, naš gost ovde bio je Aleksa Brković, koji je sa Fakulteta organizacionih nauka otišao na Barton College posle, čini mi se, 2 godine studija. Nadam se da ne grešim. Ali to je isto tako bio neki njegov utisak. On je imao priliku da se oproba i ovde i u inostranstvu i nekako je sebe više pronašao tamo baš zbog tog sistema. Opet, naravno, ne mogu da ne pomenem da je ovde studentski sport iz godine u godinu na mnogo višem nivou, da su tu sada uključeni i uživo prenosi utakmica, da se sve više daje na samu promociju, ali opet nekako smo, naravno za Amerikom, dosta godina unazad. Šta vas dve očekujete od vaših koleđa? Pre svega, za koje ste se koleđa opredelile? Rekli ste mi da je to što se vašeg upisa tiče, da je to sve već završeno, da su testovi engleskog položeni, sve što je bilo neophodno da biste postale deo tih univerziteta. Pa, hajmo sad ovako pojedinačno, koja na koji univerzitet ide, šta ćete studirati i šta je ono što očekujete. Hajmo opet od tebe, Ona.
Ja idem na St. Francis College u Brooklynu, u Njujorku. Studirat ću, pa treba da se posavetujem tamo sa tim savjetnicima studentskim. Uglavnom, nešto vezano za biologiju, verovatno neka genetika, molekularna biologija ili tako nešto. Šta očekujem? Pa očekujem baš to da dobijem priliku da stvarno da nastavim da se profesionalno bavim sportom, ali uz to da mogu da nastavim svoju edukaciju i da mogu da studiram u isto vrijeme sa tim. Naravno, očekujem jedno ogromno iskustvo u Njujorku, gde si u centru sveta, da kažem, gde ti je sve dostupno i eto, da upoznam naravno neke divne ljude tamo za koje se nadam da će mi biti prijatelji celog života.
Nevala?
Ja idem na univerzitet u Cincinnatiju. Moj major je undecided major, uprilike opšti smer. Mogu da biram predmete, ali ja ću verovatno izabrati neke ekonomske predmete, pošto sam išla u ekonomsku školu. I veoma sam uzbuđena i očekujem da dobijem dobro znanje i dobro obojkaško znanje.
Znači da napreduješ i na polju ekonomije kojom si se do sada bavila, odnosno za koju si se školovala, ali isto tako i na odbojkaškom nivou.
Da, i izbog putovanja sam uzbuđena i upoznavanja novih ljudi.
Evo, čuli smo od žene kako izgleda zapravo studentsko takmičenje, koliko zemalja se obiđe. Naravno, sad pošto govorimo o Americi, to je nekako mora tako. Ali, eto, čuli smo i te neke i dobre i te neke loše strane, odnosno kako vas sistem stavlja u taj neki šablon, kako vas, ajde da tako kažem, tera da se jednostavno uskladite, jer drugčije nećete moći da funkcionišete. Čuli smo da postoji mnogo pravila koja se moraju poštovati, ali evo, kao što ste videla, žena srećno zadovoljna, tako da ne sanjam da ćete i vas dve biti. Ono što bih isto jako volila da vas pitam, to je, pošto znam da ste upoznali Terezu Crawford tokom aprilskog kampa, ona je jedna od poznatijih američkih odbojkašica, udata je ovde, u Srbiji je, i često koristi priliku da sa mladim odbojkašicama porazgovara, da im uputi neke savete. A ono što je opet vezuje za tu neku sferu vašeg interesovanja jeste to što je ona na svom koleđu došla do 3. mesta u istoriji po broju datih poena, igrala je i za američku reprezentaciju. I ono što mene jako zanima je kako je ona uticala na vas, odnosno taj neki razgovor sa njom, ti savjeti koje vam je uputila ona?
Pa, Tereza je stvarno puno pomogla, ja mislim, svim devojkama na kampu. Jako je lepo vidjeti da neko stvarno želi toliko da podeli svoje iskustvo i da prilagodi svoje iskustvo tvom i da ti približi ono što je ona proživjela i sve to kako bi ti nekako sebi olakšao. Stvarno razgovarali smo o mnogo čemu. Svaka devojka imala priliku da, ako treba, i ceo dan razgovara sa njom o bilo čemu, da postavi bilo kakvo pitanje. Ona je stvarno dosta prošla, ona je, barem što se te sportske strane tiče, naravno i ovako kao osoba. I to je recimo jedna od njenih pointi koja je nama htjela da kaže. Jeste, vi jeste odbojkašice, to je sada najveći deo vašeg života, ali vi morate shvatiti da postoji život posle odbojke. Što ja znam opet da je dosta devojka nesvesno, jer smo mi toliko, da kažem, programirane u tom svijetu odbojke, da nam je ceo život tome podređeno, da ti jednostavno nisi toliko svestan da jednog dana ti ćeš završiti svoju karijeru i niko o tome ne razmišlja, trenutno to tebi nije u glavi i to je ono što je ona, da kažem, evo, barem meni otvorila oči u tom pravcu da jednog dana mi više se nećemo baviti odbojkom, barem na profesionalnom nivou, da će taj život završiti, a da tebe čeka jedan drugi život. I onda je pričala dosta o tom prelazu koji sigurno nije lak. Pričala je dosta stvari o igri, dakle, opet taj mentalni deo igre, kako je ona prolazila neki problemi koji se dešavaju u toku karijere, tako da zaista možeš dosta stvari da čuješ od nje i jako je značio svaki razgovor s njom.
Najmanje, si ti imala priliku da je upoznaš?
Da, ona mi je objasnila da treba da gledam sve strane, da budem pozitivna i prosto da budem srećna i da... Vrlo je divna i uvijek zna šta da kaže da ti pomogne da se osjećaš bolje.
Pronađe prave reči u pravom trenutku.
Da, to.
Jako vedra, jako nasmejana osoba. Ja sam imala priliku i da je upoznam i da par puta razgovaram sa njom. I iako nismo razgovarale toliko o profesionalnoj odbojci, stvarno imala neke savjete što se tiče života. Jako, jako korisne. Recite mi za kraj, kakvi su vam planovi za budućnost? Gde biste voljele sebe da vidite posle tog koleđa? Jel biste voljele možda da se vratite? Da se ovdje bavite odbojkom na visokom nivou, da budete deo nacionalnog tima, šta vam je ono neka želja koju ste, cilj koji ste zacrtale?
Pa ja da budem iskrena, ne znam. To se nikada ne zna, nekako ovo mi je sada da kažem, bit će za mene jedno totalno novo iskustvo. Ja uvijek znam da mogu da se vratim, naravno. Mm-hmm. Kada odlaziš tako, pa ne znam, ja sam nekako... Pa spremam na sve, što god da kažem mi tamo to iskustvo donese, da li je to, ne znam, da li ću toliko napredovati u odbojci da ću želiti da nastavim profesionalno da se bavim. Naravno, uvijek moramo biti spremni na ružne strane te priče, što ako se desi neka povreda, baš kao što je Jenna pričala, nikada ne možeš da računaš ni našta, pogotovo u sportu. Možda ću želiti da nastavim da se bavim, genetika je... da kažem, jedna oblast koja mora malo duže da se studira, tako da možda ću nastaviti na neke master i doktorske studije tamo također ili negdje u Evropi. Stvarno, za sad još ne znam.
Dobro, tako smo na početku, tako ćemo krenuti, ali nemena koja bi bio neki tvoj cilj, neka želja?
Pa, sad trenutno gledano, žela bi da se bavimo uvijekom u budućnosti, tako da... Ali naravno, ako odem tamo, nikad ne znam što nas je dan, što nas je noć, isto kao ovdje. Možda ostanem u ekonomiji, možda ne, možda ostanem u sportu, tako da sve zavisi od mene uglavnom.
Naravno. Dobro, devojke, hvala vam puno na vremenu koje ste izdvojile za naš razgovor. Hvala vam što ste bile tu i da zajedno saslušamo Jennu i da... Evo, sada popričamo o tim nekim temama. Ja se nadam da ćemo sljedeće godine u ovo vreme da razgovaramo o vašoj prvoj završenoj sezoni u inostranstvu, pa da sad malo uporedimo ova dva razgovora, da vidimo kako je bilo. Verujem da će se do tada i ti planovi i ciljevi dosta izmijeniti i da će se sve to iskristalisati. A do tada vam želim puno sreće na početku studija i stvarno vam onako iskreno želim da se jednog dana vratite i da ovdje, da ovo jednog dana bude zemlja u kojoj ćete vi moći da ostvarite sve svoje snove i nadam se da ćemo tada gledati studentski sport na mnogo, mnogo višem nivou. Hvala vam puno još jednom.
Hvala.
A vama, dragi gledalci, hvala što ste nas pratili i ove nedelje. Bilo je ovo za mene lično jedna jako posebna epizoda. Verovatno možda i najomiljenija ove sezone. Imali smo sjajne gošće i odlične teme za razgovor. Nadamo se da će tako biti i sledeće nedelje. A mi se vidimo naredno četvrtka. Hvala vam još jednom. Prijedno večer.